Good morning, or good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all to Fast Sunday here. This is the Physics of Sound with Professor Walter Lewin. He's in the physics department here at MIT. And without further ado, I think what I heard, he has some very cool experiments, as told by Emily here, a former docent over at the museum. So I'm going to let him do all the work. And Professor Lewin, please take it away.
Thank you very much. The title of the talk today is The Sounds of Music. Not the sound of music, but the sounds of music. Big difference. What is sound? That's a key question. We have to first understand what sound is. Whenever something vibrates or oscillates, which is sort of the same thing, then what it does, it pushes on the air. If I move my hand like this, pushes on the air, compresses the air, and then when I move it away, it decompresses the air. So anything that vibrates in air, as long as there is air, causes compressions of the air and decompressions of the air, and it does it many, many times. And it is this disturbance in the air that moves out in all directions, and it moves with a speed of about 760 miles per hour. So that means my friend Jeroen, who is sitting there in the back, will only hear what I say about 1/20th of a second after I really speak the words, which is no problem for him to communicate with me if we wanted that, because the distance is not very large. I want you to remember several words that will come up. And they will come up again and again during this talk. And one then is the word vibrations, which I just explained, and oscillations. And this train of compressions and decompressions, we call it a wave, sound waves we call them. But think of it as consecutive compressions and decompressions which go out in all directions. So let me write down that word also, sound wave. Think of it as a train. And this sound wave, these consecutive compressions and decompressions, they reach your eardrum. And so when there is a compression, your eardrum goes in, and when there's a decompression, your eardrum goes out. So your eardrum starts to shake with exactly the same rhythm that the vibrations made the sound. And so your brains tell you, I hear something. And the more oscillations per second, the higher the tone is that you hear. And the lower the number of oscillations per second, the lower the tone is. And we have to be very precise during this talk, because we're going to talk about very low tones, very, very low, and very, very high tones. And the difference we express in how many oscillations per second are produced by the source of the sound. And therefore, I have to introduce one oscillation in 1 second. We call that 1 hertz. That's just a name. It's called after the famous German physicist who discovered in 1889 radio waves. There comes that word waves comes back in again. So it's named after him. It's in honor of him. We only write that as Hz, by the way. So 1 hertz means that something oscillates once per second. It takes 1 whole second for 1 oscillation. 10 hertz means it goes 10 times back and forth in 1 second. 100 hertz means it goes 100 times back and forth in 1 second. And I will use that name hertz all the time during this talk. You cannot hear below 20 hertz. Don't ask me why. In fact, most of you probably won't even hear 30 hertz very well. But you can hear very well 100 hertz, 1,000 hertz, 2,000 hertz. But when we reach 20,000 hertz, your hearing also stops. You can't hear beyond 20,000 hertz. And those of you who, in my audience, who are old, that includes myself, they are lucky if they can hear 6,000 hertz. In other words, you lose your hearing at high frequencies when you get older. And here's another word that you're going to hear, and that is that word frequencies. Low frequency means not so many oscillations per second. High frequency means many oscillations per second. So low frequency is a low tone. High frequency is a very high tone. I have here three different tuning forks. This one produces a tone of about 440 hertz. So we physicists would say the frequency is 440 hertz. And this one is 256 hertz. You can hear that very well. You'll hear it in a minute. And this one is a little over 4,000 hertz. No one of you will have any difficulties hearing this one. So let's first start with a low frequency of about 256 hertz. I hit it. Any one of you cannot hear it? That's a good thing, because you might as well leave right now. So remember, the tone is quite low. We call it low frequency. So these prongs of the tuning fork go back and forth 256 times per second. So fast you can't see it. This one is 440. That's higher. It's the middle A of the piano. Higher frequency. You hear it? And then here is one that is 4,000. It's very high. Even unpleasant, isn't it? 4,000 is the highest tone that the piano can produce. The piano goes from 27 hertz, the lowest key, to the highest key, which is 4,000 hertz. So, just to make you feel at home, let me test your hearing and see how good it is. And for those of you who are old, you may be in for a surprise, because you may not hear all the way to the end. So I will start somewhere around 40 or 50, 60 hertz, which doesn't mean that you cannot hear 20, but it's very hard for us to produce 20 hertz at strength. It's not so easy. So I will start a little higher than you may like. So let's start at 60 hertz. So be quiet now. Who cannot hear this? You can all hear it. It's not very loud. That's not because you anything wrong with your ears, but that's the limitation of our loudspeaker. So this is 60 hertz. Let's now go to 100. Go to 200. So let's now go to 440, which is that tuning fork. Perhaps you remember the tone. Hear it? Too loud for you. Boy, you have good ears. If you feel uncomfortable, you have two choices. Tell me or leave. Tell me. Yeah, that's another possibility. Okay, we're going to 600. 800. 1400, 2000, I have no problems with 2000 hertz, so now we go to 4000, remember this, we're very close to this, about the same pitch, we use that word pitch, same frequency, so now we're getting into the dangerous domain. 6,000. I can still hear it. Who cannot hear it? Good for you. 8. I don't hear it. I cannot hear it. But of course, I'm in a disadvantaged position because I have hearing aids, so I have a disability. So 8,000. That's it. I cannot hear 8,000. So let's go to 10,000. Who cannot hear 10,000? Yeah? I won't ask for your age, but that's the way it goes. Okay. 12,000. If you can't hear it, just raise your hand and then we'll know slowly. It's not a competition, but I'll see who the winners are. 14,000.
Barely.
14,000, you can't hear it anymore. Don't feel bad about it. I wish I could hear 12. 16,000. You see, a lot of even young kids. Don't feel bad about it. You never need 16,000 when you have a bus ride or anything or your television station. Never. 18,000. Who can hear 18,000? Be very quiet. Who can hear it? Wow, Adriana. Wow. Who can hear 20,000? Can hear it. I'll go higher. I'll go to 25,000. I have to first switch the. Pick it up at 20,000 now. 20,000. Who can hear 20,000? Yeah? 25,000. Are you sure? Yeah? 25, yeah, it's 25. I'll increase the volume a little. 25, who can hear 25?
Okay.
I'll go to 30. Now 30. I'll increase the volume. Who can hear 30? I just turned it off. You never heard 30. But you did hear 25. So much for your objectivity. All right. I want to give you a short introduction to string instruments. Suppose I have here a string. Nice string. You see one here. And I hold it firm here, and I hold it firm there. Cannot move for now, like this. But what I'm going to do, on this end here, I'm just going to shake it just a little bit, not very much, just a teeny weeny little bit. And I start doing that at very low frequency. You know the word frequency now? Very low frequency. Maybe I do it with 2 hertz. 2 oscillations per second. I go to 3 hertz. String is not doing very much. String is not very happy. It just sits there, looks at me, laughs at me, nothing happens. And then all of a sudden, when I increase that frequency, the string responds in a very clear way. You are going to see that. And you'll see that the string goes up like this, and then it goes down. And it happily continues to do this. This vibration, which the system likes very much, we have a name for that. And we call that a resonance frequency. With which the system really likes to oscillate. It didn't like my 2 hertz. It didn't like my 4 hertz. But oh boy, when I hit a particular frequency, as you will see, then it happily goes woom, 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 like this. We call that a resonance frequency. Also, which is a nice word, we call that a natural frequency. Natural. It's very natural for that string to do this. It doesn't want to go 2 hertz, it wants to go 6 hertz. And we call this mode in which it oscillates, we call that the first harmonic. First harmonic. It means it cannot oscillate nicely in its natural way. It cannot oscillate at a lower frequency. That's why we call it the first. Now, sometimes I may misspeak. I try not to, because some books, some physics books, call this also the fundamental. So I will write it down. But I will try to avoid that word so that we never get confused. First harmonic. So now I go to a little bit higher frequency. I shake it a little faster. And this wonderful mode goes away, it stops. String is not doing much. Sitting there, bored, and I go faster and faster and faster, and all of a sudden, again, it's very happy. There is another natural frequency. It shows another resonance. And the shape of that string then is such that this point stands still. And when this is up, this is down. And it goes like this. And you will see that. It's very happy. It's a natural frequency. It loves that frequency. And we call that the second harmonic. So then I go to higher frequency. Is that in the middle? It's meant to be in the middle. I go to higher frequency, shaking it. Frequencies go away. I don't see this one. I don't see this one. But then all of a sudden, a third one comes in. And the third one, you've guessed it, is going to look like this. This point stands still, and this stands still. And when this is down, this is up, and then this is down. And this is called the third harmonic. And I could go on. I get a whole series of natural frequencies, a whole series of resonance frequencies, and the string only likes that series. It doesn't like any other. If the frequency, if that were the case, of the lowest possible frequency, which is the first harmonic, if the first harmonic were 100 hertz, and that depends, of course, from instrument to instrument, so I just picked the 100, that's an easy number, then the second harmonic is 200 hertz, and then the third harmonic is 300 hertz. So they come in a very easy series. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc. This is only true if the first harmonic is 100. If the first harmonic were 400 hertz, well, then the second would be 800, and the third one would be 1200. So once you know what the first harmonic is, sometimes also called the fundamental, but remember, I wasn't going to use that word anymore, then you know the others. Why is it that certain strings have a lower fundamental than other strings? Well, that depends on three things. The first thing that is very important is the length of the string. If you make the string longer, then the first harmonic, the lower frequency than a shorter string. The shorter the string, the higher the frequency. Then there is tension in the string. You can take the string and you can do this, put a lot of tension on it, even more, and then it breaks. Then you went too far, of course. But you can change the tension. If the tension goes up, the first harmonic also goes up. If the length goes up, the first harmonic goes down. And then there is a third ingredient, and you can see that when you look at violins and when you look at pianos, and that is how much the string weighs. So it is the weight of the string. But if I try to be very precise, and I really have to, because all of you are going to be scientists sooner or later, it is really the weight per foot. It's not just the weight of the whole string that matters, but it is the weight for a section which is, say, as long as a foot. And if I make that go up, then the first harmonic goes also down. So you have three ways if you build an instrument, and you want many, many tones to get out of the instrument, like a piano, then you have three ways of getting your lowest frequency, your harmonic. String longer, get a lower frequency. You can make the tension lower, you get a lower frequency. You can make the weight per foot higher, you also get a lower frequency. And so you have a lot of room to play with. I have a very special violin string. There's this one. Now, I need some help. I need some help from someone who is strong and who is reliable. That's all.
Oh, I gotta meet you.
I want someone. You're too strong. So what is your name?
Joseph.
Yeah. Joseph, you're strong?
Yeah.
Are you reliable?
Yeah.
Good for you. So Marcos, if you can turn the light down a little. We have this, okay, so if you come a little bit this way, no, maybe that's a little bit, give me first a little bit of light so that they can get the idea, and then we'll make it darker so that you see the robot. So here, no, stay where you are, see, you're not reliable. Go like a brick a little bit. Right, stay where you are now, yeah. So now I have this string, it's a very long string, and I give it a certain tension, which I'm not going to change. So, are you comfortable, Joseph? I'll go a little bit further back. Okay, hold it. So we're not going to change the tension, and we're not going to change the length, that's a given, and the weight per foot is also a given, we're not going to change that. And I'm going to shake it very slowly. And you see, nothing happens. That string is just laughing at us. I mean, it's an insult. It's a complete insult. But now I'm going to go faster. Look at my hand. I increase now the frequency of my hand. I don't go very far. I go faster and faster. And now look. Now look. Now look. Now it's getting there. Now look how happy it is. This is the first harmonic. It likes this frequency. And my hand is really not moving very much. Look at my hand. It's almost not moving at all. And you see that picture on the board, first harmonic. So now I go a little bit faster. And it starts laughing again. Nothing. 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 Ah. I went too fast, did I? I want one. Yeah. Here. Second harmonic. Second harmonic. It's very happy. My hand is not moving very much. Second harmonic. Let's now go for the third. I go a little faster. You see, it does nothing. I go a little faster. It does nothing. A little faster. A little faster. There it is. Third harmonic. 2 points in the middle are not moving. Not quite in the middle. The 2 points of the string are just standing still. And of course, Joseph's hand is also standing still. And now I'll try to go the highest harmonic that I can possibly generate. And you count. And you tell me then later how many of those mountains and valleys you saw. If you see 1 point that is not moving, that is already the second harmonic. If there are 2 points not moving, that's the third harmonic. So if you count 4 points, it's the fifth harmonic. But I can do better than that. Okay. I'm trying to go. See, I must hit this resonance. And when the system. Yeah! No, I lost it. I lost it. Yeah! I got one. What was it? Fifth harmonic?
Yeah.
Sixth harmonic? Do I hear six? Do I hear seven?
35.
Joseph, you and I saw 13, right? It was the 13th harmonic, right? He's also an honest guy.
Strong,
honest, and reliable. Okay, so you see, that's the way that strings behave, and that's exactly the way that strings behave of musical instruments. Here is a string that we can also oscillate, not by hand, but we have a little motor here that can make this part go up and down. And the idea is that we are going to put it for you in the third harmonic. And the frequency is so high in the third harmonic that you can really not see that this is up and that this is down. It goes too fast. You could with the other spring, but not here. And so then we are going to strobe it with strobe light to make you see the string more or less stand still, though not quite, but almost. Let's first see whether we can get it into this harmonic. It's very delicate. We may have to change the frequency. That's pretty good. So you see here a point that is standing still. So two stand still, third harmonic. So it's at resonance now. We call this at resonance. It's at its natural frequency. It's driven there, just the right frequency. See, it goes too fast. You cannot see it stand here, stand and there. That's too fast. So now we're going to put a strobe light on it. And the strobe light throws light on it, goes on and off, on and off, on and off, on and off, which is about the same frequency. About the same. We cannot exactly get it the same. And so you're going to see now that the rope will stand still or slowly move. That's only, of course, an optical illusion. In reality, it goes like this, but it makes it, we make it look stand still. That's the way that we cast the light on it. Okay? If you're ready for it, Marcos? Let's see. Turn that off there. So I have a green light strobe on. Where is the... Oh, the lecture light is here, right? Okay, look at that. So you see the green stroboscope is at a frequency very close to the way that the rope is moving, and so it looks like it's standing still. If I can try to do a little better, but it's not so easy. I can try to perhaps no, I went in the wrong direction. It's not so important that I hit it exactly, as long as you get the idea. But what I can also do now, I can turn this into a work of art, and I can put on a second stroboscope in red, which I flash twice as fast. So it illuminates the rope twice during one complete oscillation. So you see the rope double in red and single in green. And let's do that now. I'll have to do the best I can. 590, that becomes 1180. Should be very close now. Should be very close. So you see it twice in red, you see it once in green. Nice to have that in your living room. Excuse me?
Is it because it's slightly out of phase that it came
in? Sure, because you see, we cannot exactly hit it at the right frequency. So therefore, you get a phenomenon that it moves very slowly. If we play with it long enough, here, now the green and the red are almost, you see, they're exactly, they coincide. So I can change that very easily by changing the frequency of the green one a little. And then, of course, the green one will go. So you see also here, apart from the fact that it's a nice sculpture, you see now the idea that there are points here standing still. They have a name, we call them nodes. And there, this system is oscillating now in the third harmonic. It's a natural frequency. We only excite it in one frequency. Okay. I'm not sure I got all the lights on Marcos, but when we have a violin string or another string on a cello, bass, or whatever, there is no such thing like someone who is vibrating it at the end. So you have to make it vibrate. And you do that by having a bow. And so you effectively rub the string. And when you rub it, that is sort of the same as saying to the string, do whatever you like. And what the string likes is this and that and that. And it doesn't like anything in between. So what the string is now going to do, if you just rub it, or even if you pluck it, or even if you would hit it with a hammer, which is what you do with the piano, a hammer comes down on the string, that's all that happens with the piano, it then starts to oscillate simultaneously at a combination of these harmonics. In general, the lowest frequency is the strongest, the first harmonic, in general, but not always. That depends on where you would pluck it. So now comes the question, how do you tune an instrument? People have a violin, they come in, they want to play it, and you may have noticed that they tune it. Well, there's nothing they can do about the weight per foot of the strings. There are four strings on a violin, that's a given. So that they cannot change that. The length is fixed. You have a violin, the length of that thing. So the only thing they can change is the tension. And that's exactly what they do. You may have noticed that, and when we see later a demonstration of a violin, we'll ask the person to tune it. They turn these knobs, they change the tension, and then they listen. And then they're ready. And they do that on all four strings. So you tune a string instrument by changing the tension. Of course, with the piano, that would be hopeless. And so there you hope that it is properly tuned. The piano has 88 keys. How do you play an instrument? Well, with a violin, once it's properly tuned, the only thing you can do now, if you want to make every tone that you would like to, you can only change the length. And you change the length by putting your finger on the string and making a string shorter and longer. If you take this string and you put your finger on here, you support it here, then the fundamental has a lower length. And a lower length, remember, higher frequency. So you get a higher tone. So as the violin player moves the finger in, one and the same string will produce a higher tone. And that's the way you play it. That's an amazing thing when you come to think of it. All the time you've got to move these fingers in and out to always get that right length. And if you're just off by a little bit, it sounds awful. You don't have that problem with a piano. You go bing, and right, just the right tone. Again bing. So it's a whole different ball game playing a piano. I'm not saying that piano playing is easier because you've got to know which key to push. But in any case, you don't have to adjust all the time the length of the strings. In principle, you could design a string instrument whereby you do change the tension. And there is such an instrument with one string that the person plays it with a bow. And as the person plays it, he or she changes the tension all the time. And when my daughter was 3 years old, which is a long time ago, she built such an instrument. This is one, this is a box, and this is one string. And when you put this on here, I will not strike it with a bow, because for that I need three hands now, and I only have two, but I will pluck it. And then you will hear that I can pluck it and change the tension by moving this to the right. I increase the tension on the string, and you hear a higher tone than when the tension is lower. The length is not changing. The weight per foot is not changing, but now the tension is changing. Listen carefully. You hear it?
Yeah.
So in principle, you could design an instrument, and they do exist, whereby you change the tension all the time. And that, of course, a lot of practicing. So instead of changing the length, you change the tension. All right, so far, so good on our string instruments. Now it's going to be more difficult. Before we demonstrate the string instruments, I want to discuss with you wind instruments. They work very differently. Let this be a hose or a pipe. And there is air in here. It has a certain length. And on one side, I blow air. And later we can discuss how you have to blow. But let's, for now, think of it that we have here a vibrating, oscillating mechanism that changes its frequency from very low to very high. Something similar will happen that happened to the string. At certain frequencies, it will do nothing. And then all of a sudden, it's very happy. It produces a tone. We call that the first harmonic. At higher frequency, second harmonics. Even higher frequency, third harmonic. You may think now that it is the pipe that is vibrating. Because the string was vibrating, so here you think it's the pipe. That is not true. It is the air inside the pipe that starts to oscillate in a way that is extremely hard to imagine, not only for you, but also for me. But except for now, that it is the air column inside that is actually going to pulsate, so to speak. And it is then at certain frequencies that you will hear the harmonics, the resonance frequencies. And I'll give you an example. If the length of this pipe is 1 foot and 2 inches, notice how precise I am, the first harmonic would be 500 hertz. And that's it. You cannot change that. You don't have the leeway with strings, and you can change the tension, you can change the length. There's no such thing as changing tension. Neither is there such a thing as changing the weight per unit length. You can't do that either. So you're really stuck with length. This instrument, however, is also very happy to produce a second harmonic, which it will do at 1,000 hertz. And it is very happy producing a third harmonic, which it will do at 1,500 hertz. Similar to the string. Remember, 1, 2, 3. If you make this twice as short as this one, so you make it shorter now, exactly half the length, then the first harmonic will go up. It will become 1,000 hertz. And so the second will become 2,000, and the third one will become 3,000. So the length is a crucial thing. The longer the instrument, the lower the tone. The shorter the instrument, the higher the tone. A flute is very short, produces very high tones. A tuba is very big, produces very low tones. But now there is a complication. And the complication is the following. You can also design an instrument whereby you close it on one end, whereby it's not open on both ends. And when you do that, if the length of the two are the same, your first harmonic is half this frequency. So it becomes 250. So you have exactly the same length, 1 foot and 2 inches. And I use this symbol now. And now you'll get here 250. What do you think you're going to get here now?
500.
Yeah, that's what all you would say, but that's not true. Sorry that I set you up for this. I told you there is really a complication here. It turns out that now the next one is 3 times this, which is 750, and the next one is 5 times this, which is 1250. So now you don't get the sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, but you get 1, 3, 5, 7, and so on. You may forget that if you prefer that. Since we are going to listen to instruments, and since we want to get a feeling now for what tones one can produce with wind instruments, I give you here a scheme which will help you for the rest of this talk. You see there in white only the first harmonic. And the numbers are given in hertz. And this is the length of the instrument. This is open, open. and this is closed open. And now notice, if you have 1 inch, this short only, then you would be able to produce 6700 hertz, and your second harmonic would then be twice that. If you make it 4 inches, the frequency goes down by exactly a factor of 4. This is 4 times lower than that. 12 inches, 3 times lower. 40 inches must be 10 times lower than 4 inches. And you see that is the case. And 100 inches, of course, is a monster that is this big. You will get 67 hertz, and this would be the second harmonic. I only put the second harmonic in the first and the last. If now, with the same length, you go to this system, notice that these values are half. This is half, this is half, this is half, this is half. And to please this gentleman, the second harmonic is 3 times higher. So this number is 3 times this, and this number is 3 times that. And then the third harmonic is 5 times that. So you have to hold on to this. Why can I not give you such a scheme for strings? Why can I not put a screen here, a table, and say if the string is this long, this is the first harmonic. If the string is that long, that's the first. Why can I not do that? Because what?
The other two variables.
Exactly. The length alone doesn't tell me the tone. I have to know the tension, and I have to know the weight per foot. So that's why. I can only do this for wind instruments. I have here a system, very famous instrument that we built here. It's made of wood. It's open here, and it's open here. I can generate very easily the first harmonic, the lowest possible frequency. Listen. But now, I put my hand here. I make it now a closed open system. And now you should see here half the frequency. My hand was partially covering it. And here is one that is a little longer. So if I compare these two, will this tone be higher or lower than this one? This tone will be lower. And what happens when I put my hand on it? Higher or lower? Okay. I have here a hose. And everyone will agree with me that this is open on both ends. I can even see you. You can see me? No, you can't see me, right? But I can see you. It's open, and it's open. The air inside can be made to resonate. There's that word resonate again. That is its natural frequency. We make it resonate at the fundamental. And you should be able to read from this table what that fundamental is. You have to know then roughly how long this is. Well, what do you think it is? How many inches is this? Is about maybe 3 feet. 3 feet is about 36 inches. 36 is close to 40, not quite. So you're operating somewhere in this range. It's probably a little shorter, 36 inches. So the frequency is a little higher than 100, maybe 200 hertz or so. How do I excite that? Well, I can swing it around, and then air passes by, and in a way that is quite mysterious. If you just blow that air at the right speed, it really starts to oscillate, to resonate in that first harmonic, and you will hear that 200 hertz. If you swing it a little faster, since it's open, you hear the second harmonic, which is then double that frequency. If you go faster again, you hear the third harmonic. It is very difficult for me to excite the first harmonic. Very difficult. But I'll try that. But when I start swinging it, the chances are that you will immediately hear the second harmonic, which is then roughly 400 hertz. And then later I will try to get the lowest one. So let's go. This is the second harmonic. It's around 400 hertz. Third harmonic. second harmonic. Now I'll try to get the first. That's the first. That's the first. Second, first. So this is a wind organ. How do you tune a wind instrument? Well, your first thought should be you can't tune it. There's nothing you can do about it. Well, those of you who play wind instruments can probably tell us, as a musician told me, that when he starts playing the clarinet, that all he can do is change the position of the mouthpiece a little bit, moving it in or out. And when he does that, he makes it a little longer or a little shorter. That's what he does. That's all he can do. There's nothing else that you can do. And that's the way they try to get the frequency just right for the other instruments in the orchestra. How now do you produce different tones? Well, apart from the fact that if you blow at certain ways that you can probably get second harmonics and third harmonics, it's not so easy. You hold your lips in certain ways and go, then you can actually excite a very high harmonic. Apart from that, what you can also do is make the instrument shorter or longer. And how do you do that? You just drill holes in it. That's what you do. And so you put your fingers on both holes, then it is this long. And then you can see there what tone you produce. Then if you do this, well, it's open here. So now it's now shorter. So now frequency is up. You take your finger off, now it's only this short. So now the frequency goes even up. And then if you're very experienced, yeah, you go like this and you play it. Did you hear it? Wonderful, isn't it? That's all it takes. You make your instrument longer and shorter, and that's exactly what a flute is doing. Here, that's our trombone. It's open here, and it's open here. Now it's open. No longer. When I do this, it's now closed open. And so when I make it longer, I would see I get a low tone, and when I make it shorter, I would get a high tone. And there you can tell what the tones would be. And then by going back and forth, you can play a tune. And I'll make an attempt to do that. All right, you see, it's not that easy to play music. All right, that is a trombone. So when you play an instrument, a string instrument, you pluck it, and when you play a wood instrument, you blow air, and then the instrument starts to oscillate simultaneously, first, second, third, and higher harmonics, and that is what determines the tone quality of that particular instrument. It is the cocktail of the various harmonics that make you recognize the instrument, and that is very different for the very instrument. So you don't just produce one tone in general, but you produce more than one simultaneously. I want you to not only listen to the various instruments, but I want you to see what tones are produced. And the way that I'm going to do that is as follows. Imagine that I have here a tuning fork, and that the tuning fork is oscillating like this, and that I attach to the tuning fork a pen, ink, and here I have a piece of paper, and I'm going to move that piece of paper as I oscillate that tuning fork. And then I look at that piece of paper later, and what I see is a line like this. And that tells me then how the prong of the tuning fork moved up and down. It would be nice if I could do the same with your eardrums. So I attach to your eardrum a pen with ink, and if someone plays the violin, and the violin has this harmonic, we would see on the piece of paper that line. But if at the same time the violin produces the second harmonic, then you would see this. In addition to that, and your eardrum simultaneously follows the low frequency and the higher frequencies. The net result is that if we look at the recording on the piece of paper, that it looks very complicated. Because you get not only this wiggle, but on top of this wiggle, you get the red wiggle. And that I can show you without going into your ears. We take a microphone. And the microphone is like your ears. And we pick up that signal from the microphone, and we show that to you. You will see it there. And then you will see a trace, in a similar way that you see it there, of what the harmonics are that are produced by the various instruments. And we have students who came in with instruments. Is Holly Everett here? Okay, Holly, you can come with your instrument. What kind of instrument do you... You're going to bring a viola, right? Okay, come in with your viola. Maybe you can show it. So this is Holly. Excuse me?
Should I take it out?
Yeah, take it out, sure. We have various people. We have... is it Olga Hall with a flute? Yeah? That's Olga. Let's first start with two, and then the others will come shortly. If you come on this side, Olga, also, and show the audience your flute. Maybe you can tune it. That would be nice, and we know how you tune an instrument, or you don't have to tune it, you think. What do you think, Holly? You have to tune it, or is it not necessary? I think it's out of tune completely. Don't you think you want to tune it? Not really, okay. Holly doesn't want to tune it. So I can't demonstrate this tension thing, because that's all you would do, right? You would change here these knobs. I think it was on. So you would change these knobs here to increase and decrease the tension, right? Now, you also ready? Can you show this? Don't play it yet. That's a beautiful instrument. That's a flute, right? Mm-hmm. You see all these valves here? Those are these openings. See, her instrument is not all that different from this. Yeah. Oh, just a few more holes, but that's about it.
A lot more expensive.
Who's talking money? You're now at MIT. So, if I can produce... just one fundamental, one first harmonic, you remember I wasn't going to use that word fundamental, then it looks very boring. And I'm going to do that first by making you listen to a tuning fork. So Marcos, if we can get this up here, is that the first switch?
Yep.
So it's important that you're quiet, because all the sound you make, you're going to see there. But let's first look at this boring 440 hertz with nothing else. No overtones, only first harmonic. This is roughly 440. If I made you listen to 256, you would see farther apart, of course, because
no.
It goes slower.
Yes.
Thank you. 256. Now, what I would like Holly to do first is try to produce something that is very close to 440. This is 440. And then you will see immediately the difference between your violin and this tuning fork. I'll follow the instructions by Craig.
Yes, stand right there.
There's the microphone. So try to make that 440. You don't have to be exactly, but roughly. Now hold it, just keep doing it. You did fine. Looks different, doesn't it? You see all those higher harmonics? A lot of higher harmonics. So as she strikes it with the bow, she is exciting now many different harmonics. So now why don't you play something for us to entertain my guests? Yes. You can do that? And then we will watch you. Not you, of course, you don't have to worry, watch you there. You can play anything. But you don't have to. Then think about it. Let's first listen to the flute. Can you try the 440? Or come close? Yeah, go ahead. It's nice, but it lacks the richness that you saw in the violin. It doesn't have as many higher harmonics as the violin did. Can you play something for us, 30 seconds or so? Oh, you have brought music. Yeah, go ahead. I'll make sure that we don't... Oh, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, you just play whatever you want to play. Go ahead. One more tone. Oh, you did great. That's fine. Thank you very much. Joseph Gilden has a violin. We saw the viola of Holly, and now we get a violin, which is a little smaller. Maybe we can hold one next to the other so that you can actually see that the viola is a little larger. So on. Oh, my goodness, yeah. Why did I invite you in the first place then? I don't know. Okay, so since the instruments are not full size, you may not be able to compare them. Yeah, do you have a viola? You have a violin, right? Can you show it to us? Yep. This is Joseph Gilden. Ah, it is smaller, isn't it? Yeah, Holly, show your instrument again. And hold this up. Here, make the tent here. Yeah, yours is bigger. But it's not a full-size instrument. So the tones that that instrument produce will be a little lower on average than what this instrument can produce because the strings are shorter. But of course, the tension adds to it, and that makes it much harder to make any predictions about the frequencies. So can you get the 440? I'll have to change the amplification again, I think. Yeah, go ahead. You see that same richness that we saw on the viola. Many, many, many. You think you can play something?
Yeah, I can.
Yeah, go ahead. Music. Oh, you need the music. Go ahead.
I won't do that.
You can use the music. There's nothing wrong with that. I use my lecture notes. Same thing. It's up to you. You want me to hold it up for you?
No.
That's what I sometimes do in the middle of a lecture, just close the book. Okay, go ahead. Yeah, do! Yeah! Yeah! And show them what you do. Teeny weeny little screws there. Changes the length. He is moving the string by a teeny weeny little bit by changing the screw that he has here. Yeah, go ahead. Thank you. almost made me cry. No, you did terrific, thank you. Very kind of you. We have some other surprises for you. My graduate student, ex-graduate student, John Miller is here. He's now working at Harvard. And he has a didgeridoo. In fact, there's a history behind that didgeridoo. A didgeridoo is not so different from this. It's open here. It's open here. You can look through it. They can see you. And here's Dave Pooley. He's also an ex-graduate student of mine. And they had a bet together. They bought this, I don't know where, probably in Australia. And whoever finished first, whoever got his PhD first, got this didgeridoo. John walked away with it. But now the price that he's going to pay for that. I want to see a 440 hertz, John. And look at that here. That is close to 40 inches, right? Close. So his fundamental is 168. So to get a 440, he got to get it up by roughly 2.5, 3 times that. Good luck, John. That was a good 50 hertz. There's no way you can get 440 out of that instrument. He's sweating now, believe me. Try it again. No, try it again. The highest tone you can possibly spit. You have to spit. You go like that. Yeah. I think you're getting your 168. That's all you can do.
Yeah.
Now, can you play it for us? Something very exciting.
That was it.
Oh, that was it. We have Emily, who is a student of mine now in physics of waves and oscillations and vibrations. And look what she brought. If you think this is a trombone, wait till you see what she brought. That's a real trombone. Stand a little, not too close to that, because I know you're going to have a fantastic, yeah? Okay, get to 440 roughly. Okay, now, if you notice closely, the 220 is stronger than the 440, if you look closely. So when she tries to get a 440 and she succeeds, there is still a harmonic lower than the 440, and she cannot change that. We practiced that already before you came in. Try it again. Okay, this is 440. You see? She can only get 220 and 440. But that's the way it is. That's not your fault. That's why there's a trombone. Can you play something? Instruments before we'll have a 10-minute break. We have Ian Smith with the French horn. Ian Smith not here. Okay, so we'll miss the French horn, so you have your break earlier. And then we'll have a keyboard, Justin Murkison. And Justin is 6 years old. He's going to play for us the keyboard, which we have here. Do you think you can get something close to the middle A on the piano, which was the 440 hertz? You sure your instrument is turned on?
A or middle C?
Yeah, go ahead. Do it again. Go ahead. Oh, yeah. Go ahead. You see, you really recognize that 440 separation, but there are some overtones on there. There are some harmonics on it. Do it again, yeah? Now you can play something if you want that. Sing here, who can produce a 440? Anyone who wants to volunteer singing, just try it to see how pure you can make the tone. Yeah, come on. Oh, you have competition already. And what is your name?
Cassandra.
Cassandra? Hey, Cassandra, can you try to sing a 440 for me, or close to that? I'll make you listen to it once more.
Okay.
Go ahead, do it once again.
La.
Not too easy, to sing a pure tone. That's pure. You try it. Sing something then, just in anything you want. There are a lot of beautiful overtones in your voice. You want to try it?
Yeah.
You have competition.
Yeah.
Get the 440.
Ooh.
Very good. Again.
Ooh.
What's your name?
Akshan.
Sherry. And now sing something. Okay, we'll see you back here in 10 minutes, so you can just walk around a little and stretch your legs.
It's hard.
Does it tell you?
If you walk around, you'll... This is...
So you've seen a violin, and you've seen the viola, and you may have noticed that the strings are attached to something like a box, right? The underpart of the viola, which is called the soundboard. The piano also has a soundboard. And this soundboard is a must for you to hear the tone. If you have a string, and you would oscillate that string, at its resonance frequency, you would pluck it and it would go into those harmonics, you wouldn't hear it. The reason is that the amount of air displaced is so little because the string is so small that there is just not enough disturbance in the air that you can hear it. And so what you do, you mount these strings on a box, on a surface, in the case of the piano, soundboard is just a big piece of wood, and that piece of wood starts to oscillate because the string oscillates and the string is mounted on it, and so the whole board starts to oscillate, and now the amount of air that is displaced is much higher, and now you can hear it. And this is easy to demonstrate. I have here a tuning fork for a 40. It's not mounted on anything. If I bing it, you can hardly hear it at all. I can now, you can't hear it. But if I put it on a box or on the table, then you will be able to hear it. I'll do it once more. Even the table is enough. So that's the function of these soundboards. And that's the reason why these tuning forks are all mounted on boxes, which is the soundboard, and so that makes the sound loud enough for you to hear. I have here tuning, a little music box. There's little prongs. And as I rotate this drum around, these little prongs do this. They oscillate different frequencies. I don't think you can hear it. Not impressive, right? You ready? I can put it on the table. But that's the reason why you need a large surface to oscillate. In the old days, I remember that in wine cellars, the owner of the wine cellar could tell what the level of the wine was in the barrel. And he would do that by knocking on it. And in the beginning, if he's at the level where there is liquid, very little sound. But when he reaches the hollow part, very loud. So that upper part can easily oscillate, but the liquid cannot. So that's one way of telling which of this barrel is filled with some substance and which is hollow. If I had no brains at all, and if I would bang this tuning fork and put it on my head and open my mouth, you would hear a loud tone. I can demonstrate this to you. Not impressive, right? You don't hear much. Well, that's maybe why I'm at MIT. Now here's my ex-graduate student, John Miller. Now just stay there, John, because... Just to stay where you were. John, very smart fellow. So we can also test whether he has any brains. He's getting nervous, I can tell. John, I put this tuning fork on your head and you open your mouth and we will hear nothing. You promise, right? You got your PhD, right, didn't you?
But he went to Harvard.
That's a good point. So string and wind instruments, they resonate in very unique frequencies. You're all experts now, we call them harmonics, natural frequencies. But all objects have resonant frequencies, and not just one, but a whole zoo of resonant frequencies, which sometimes are very mysterious and not so easy to predict. As an example, I have here a wine glass. And that is a very complicated piece of glass. And I can make this glass itself, I'm not talking about the air now, but about the glass itself oscillate in a zillion different resonance frequencies. And one that I can excite is easy by rubbing the rim. I have to wash my hands because I have chalk on my hands and then it won't work with chalk. I'll just rub it now. Hear it? Can you hear it? So this is one resonance frequency, but there are many. What this thing is doing, if you would strobe it with strobe light, you would see it do this, like a tuning fork. And when you have a bell and you hit a bell, it will also go into its own natural frequencies, sometimes more than one. Wind, when you see a traffic sign and there is wind, you probably have seen that on television, when hurricane is coming up, you see a traffic sign and there's just a wind blowing and the traffic sign goes like this and can even get out of control. Even signs that are hanging can actually start to swing and you can have a resonance which is so strong that it becomes destructive. You drive your car, 40 miles an hour, all of a sudden, something in the back. You go a little faster, it stops. Because your wheels go differently now. You go a little faster, it stops, something else goes. So there are all kinds of resonances in your car, and the older your car is, you know about it. It's a nuisance. There are also resonances which are of a more complex idea, and that is emotional resonances. When you fall in love, and most of you are too young for that, I presume, but that's also a resonance. So you are exposed to something, and all of a sudden you get a very strong reaction. Someone says something to you. It can hit a very sensitive nerve, and you can explode. That's a form of resonance. So there are all kinds of forms of resonances. I have here a circular plate, which is held in the middle only, the center. And I think we can show that circular plate there, if all goes well. There it is, circular plate. And I can put something on it, which is some very fine sand. And if it is not sand, Marcos will correct me. And at the center point, we're going to shake it at various frequencies. And it is extremely hard to predict what the resonance frequencies of this disc is, but there are many, I mean really dozens of them. And just with this string, you had points which did not move, we call those points nodes, where it stood still. On a surface like that, you're going to see lines, we call them nodal lines, which stand still. And that's where the sand will stay, and at the places where it is oscillating very wildly, in this case, like here, the sand will be thrown off and will accumulate at the nodal lines. So by the pattern of the sand, you can then find the resonance frequencies. And I'll make an attempt to find a very low resonance frequency. It's not always so easy. That's not so easy to predict. So here are nodal lines now. I will change the frequency. It's another resonance. Hey, look at that, that's a beauty. So that's amazing. So this stands still, and this stands still, and the rest shakes. I changed only by a trifle the frequency. And you get another resonance. I can go to higher frequencies. You look at this one. That's a beauty too. Go to higher frequencies. That's a weird one. Unbelievable. I would never have predicted something like this. So these points stand still. And there's a ring here that stands still. one ring stands still. Amazing. So this stands still, and this stands still, and the rest oscillates. All resonance frequencies. Go higher. It's another one. Higher. There's a resonance. There's a resonance. See, four rings. And so you can literally find dozens of resonances. And they are very hard to calculate. Of course, there are people who make a living out of that. And when you leave, you can actually try for yourself, apart from playing with this one. We have here some very interesting plates. They are called after the person who worked on this, Mr. Klatny. And you can try with a bow. You have here a bow. You can go like this. And as you do that, the pattern of sand, if you hit a resonance, immediately will take one of those shapes. But since this is a triangle, this is a square, and this is a circle, you will get different responses. And you should try that as you leave. It's really great fun, and we have here the sand. And then you get a good idea for the multiple frequencies that these objects can produce. Get a little bit more light. I have here an open system. And, well, if I go to the blackboard and I look at my notes, how long this system is, then I would predict that roughly 110 hertz would be the first harmonic. It is roughly 50 inches or so long, so something like 110, 120 hertz. And it's open at the bottom and it's open at the top, but there is here a grid, a copper grid. And I'm going to heat that copper grid, heat it up. And then I remove the heat, and then it's going to cool. And what is very cool, that it goes into resonance. That's amazing. And you hear the first harmonic. Just air going through somehow gives it the right stimulants, like the wind making the traffic light go this way. This system, when the airflow changes due to the cooling, it goes into resonance. Here's that grid. That resonances are very common and not always as easy and simple as the way we started with a simple string, which is very well controlled. We control the tension, we control the length, we know how much weight there is per foot. With the wind instruments, we would control the length, not much more, by the way, but everything was nicely under control and predictable to a reasonable degree. Now it becomes a whole different story when you have objects which have plates, wine glasses, and you end up with a lot of resonance frequencies. Some resonances can be so violent that they are destructive. They can actually have as a result that because the driving system, that could be the wind, or it could be heat, just puts in the right energy, and the system goes in resonance, and the system can then sometimes break. It's called, that is called destructive resonance. And one striking example of destructive resonance is so mind-boggling that when you see it, you will hardly believe it. There was a bridge built in this country in the 40s, Tacoma, Washington. Very nice and sturdy bridge, beautiful bridge. And then the wind came up, and you will see very shortly what the wind can do to a bridge. So Marcos, if you can get that video going. The wind excites a resonance frequency in the bridge, and the bridge didn't like that.
On the 1st of July, 1940, a delegation of citizens met in Washington State. The weather was beautiful, the occasion historic, and the speech-making and fanfare altogether appropriate. This was the grand opening of the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. From the beginning, the bridge, which spanned Puget Sound between Seattle and Tacoma, was traveled in style, as well it should have been. The Tacoma Narrows Bridge was one of the longer suspension bridges on Earth. And if somebody hadn't overlooked something, it probably would have remained one of the longer suspension bridges on Earth. The problem wasn't that right from the beginning, a lot of people didn't pay a lot of attention to details. They did. But somewhere along the line, and this was obvious in the end, it looks as if someone forgot the significance of resonance. Among other things, the Tacoma Narrows Bridge was the most spectacular aeolian harp in history. Unfortunately, its first performance was destined to run only about 4 months. In the meantime, she was a beautiful bridge. Beautiful, but a little strange. Even before construction was completed, people observed its peculiar behavior. That was because, even in a light breeze, ripples ran along the bridge. After a while, one of the local humorists called her Galloping Gertie. And for fairly obvious reasons, the name stuck, at least until the 7th of November, 1940. Then as now, Seattle and Tacoma were sports-minded cities. For 4 months, a regional sport was to drive across the bridge on a windy day. While some claimed it was like riding a roller coaster, others found it a little disconcerting to see the car in front disappear. How popular this bridge sport was, or to what extent it might have spread across the country, is anybody's guess. On November 7th, 1940, the winds were relatively moderate, about 40 miles per hour. A new mode appeared. Rather than ripple, the bridge began to twist. A wind of 40 miles per hour is not too strong, but it was strong enough to start the bridge twisting violently. And at 11 a.m., it fell.
You see here an amazing example of destructive resonance. Uh-oh. There is a rumor, more than a rumor, actually. Get some lights up, yeah. There's an amazing rumor that certain singers, and women are actually credited with this, that certain singers can break glass. They put a wine glass like this, and they do this. They listen carefully. They produce the tone, and the glass breaks. I don't believe it. I do believe it if that person would use loudspeakers and amplify the sound by a huge amount. Just the voice, I don't believe it. Yet, some people say they have seen it with their own eyes. I don't believe it. However, the idea of breaking a glass with sound is, of course, an intriguing idea. And so the MIT students, of course, you owe them the best you can give them. And so one of us, that was actually Professor Felt, with the help of some other people, designed a system that probably can break a glass. The reason why I say probably is it doesn't always work. Some of the glasses are tougher than others. And here we have that glass. And here we have the loudspeaker. And we're going to drive this loudspeaker with an incredible volume. And we try to hit exactly the frequency. You have to hit it exactly right of the resonance that you heard when I went with my finger like this. And it is very important that we have to hit it exactly right. And if we do that, sometimes the glass breaks. And we can show it to you. And we do that in a similar way that we did with the shaking rubber hose. We have a strobe light on top. And we strobe the glass. And as the glass goes into the resonance, the strobe light frequency is about the same as the glass, so it would stand still like this, but we make the two a little different, so you see the glass move in slow motion, just like you saw the string move in slow motion. And then if we hit exactly that right frequency, and we turn up the volume, and all of you have already moved to the back of the audience because you will go nuts, believe me, it's an enormous amount of sound that we're going to produce, I warn you, then the chances are that the glass will go like this and then break. So I want to give you a warning to at least make sure that you protect your ears. I will protect mine. I can do that with this system. In the beginning, you don't have to worry because I'm not going to turn the volume up right away. So I will give you a proper warning. But we will ultimately go all the way out. So first, let's get the strobe light. We're going to show it here, Marcos. That's the tone. The strobe light, can we see this? I don't see the strobe at the moment. Oh, yeah. So here's the strobe light. So the glass is now not, there's no sound. I don't need this yet. It just so happens, which is purely an accident, that this glass oscillates at about 440 hertz, purely accidental. We bought a few hundred of them, and they vary from about 440 to about 450. I can change the driving frequency and the volume. I'm going to try both and see whether we can make it break. So you see, it can be done, but it takes some brute force. You notice that I had to find the resonance by changing the frequency of the sound only by half a hertz or so. And then when I saw the glass respond, I turned up the volume and you saw the response. With the strings, I mentioned that the tension is important. If you change the tension, you can change with a string the first harmonic and the higher harmonics. What is it in the wind instruments that plays the role of the tension? That is really the speed of sound of air inside the instrument. Not between the instrument and you, but inside the instrument. But we have no control over that. So that's why I never mentioned it to you. There's no sense in saying that if you fill a flute, if you were to fill it with helium, and the speed of sound in helium is about almost three times higher than the speed of sound in air, you would hear a very different tone. That is useless to mention because you play your flute always in air. So it is a moot point. But if you did fill your flute, the inside, with helium, not the outside, that's not necessary, just the inside, when the air begins to oscillate itself, the helium would begin to oscillate, you get a totally different frequency. You get a much higher frequency. That is not so easy to demonstrate. However, I am willing to sacrifice for the sake of science. I've done that before. And I can fill my system, my lungs, with helium. And my entire system here with helium. And in many ways, the sound that I produce, the way I produce it, in many ways is like a wind instrument. And so the resonance frequencies that I will produce, which make up my voice, and you recognize my voice by now, you poor people had to listen to it for almost 2 hours, those resonances will change because the speed of sound in helium is about 2.5-3 times higher than in air. And chances are you won't even recognize me anymore. There's only one problem, not for you but for me. There's no oxygen in helium. And so when I take that helium in, I can faint. And it's no joke, I can. So I can't hold it for too long. But if I don't hold it long enough, then you don't hear the effect. So it's a fine line that I have to walk between fainting and not fainting. And I'll try not to faint and still make you hear this difference. You have a question, why don't we do that first before I pass out? I prefer you don't, seriously. You will see shortly why. I mean, in the best case, I get dizzy and walk out like this. That's the best thing that can happen. But my voice will change. All right? So here we have helium. This is open already.
Yes. That's all good. I just left this tube. This is
good. Oh, it's the wrong tube.
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting. That was nice of you, Marcos. Okay, so first of all the air has to go out, and then all the helium has to go in, and I have to make sure that there's no air left, so I have to blow it out again and back in again, and by that time, the hope is still alive.
Well, I told you that it's really a very different Walter Lewin who's talking to you, and I hope you enjoyed my talk. Thank you very much.
try the Klotny plates when you walk out. Thank you.
Then don't look.